And on behalf of our partners, the Daniel Pearl Foundation and UCLA Hillel, I want to invite you, welcome you to our special evening tonight. So our mission at the Burkle Center, as many of you know, is to enrich the understanding of international affairs here at UCLA, in LA, and around the world. And one of the main ways that we try to do that is by bringing the best thinkers and doers to campus to talk with us and discuss the most important issues of the day. Tonight's event is consistent with that. It's something we've done for many years and we're very proud of. Tonight we're here to honor the life and work of Daniel Pearl, who I think, as all of you know, shortly after the 9/11 attacks, was brutally murdered in Pakistan while working as a foreign correspondent for the Wall Street Journal. A free and active press has always been an essential element of our democracy, especially true today. And as a foreign correspondent, Daniel Pearl devoted his life to bringing truth to us and exposing us to the world around us. Over the years, for the Daniel Pearl Lecture, we've had many outstanding journalists and others come as lecturers, among them Christopher Hitchens, Samantha Power, Condoleezza Rice, last year, Christiane Amanpour. What we've never had before is someone from the Wall Street Journal. And so it's an honor to have with us, to share his thoughts and his views, BRET STEPHENS, the editorial page editor and Pulitzer Prize winning columnist for the journal. So I want to thank, again, our partners, the Daniel Pearl Foundation, UCLA Hillel. The way we're going to work is, as soon as I'm done with these preliminaries, I'm going to welcome up to the stage Rabbi Aaron Lerner. Following the rabbi, we'll hear a few words of remembrance from Judea Pearl. Then I'll introduce BRET STEPHENS. He's going to give us his views in a brief speech here from the podium, and then he and I are going to sit down in those chairs and have a conversation. There's a lot of steps to this. We're then going to open it up to discussion from all of you. So during the question period, please wait for the handheld microphones that we have. Please wait to be called on, of course. And I know I will appreciate it. I think everyone in the room will appreciate if you keep your questions short and to the point. So with that in mind, let me invite up Rabbi Aaron Lerner.
Thank you so much, Cal. Welcome, everyone. I want to use my moment or two to actually thank Mr. STEPHENS for a column that he wrote last year entitled A Columnist's Responsibility. In it, you described what I think is one of the most damaging cultural phenomena of our age, that being confirmation bias, which is defined as the human tendency to interpret new evidence, new information, new facts, as information that conforms with one's existing beliefs. You argued that the responsibility of a columnist is to present opinions which, quote, run against the grain of your reader's thinking. What a columnist owes his readers isn't a bid for their constant agreement, it's independent judgment. As an educator, especially at this time and on a college campus, I share with you that desire to combat the ability that we seem to have grown over the last decade to shut out inconvenient truths. Earlier this week, the Daily Bruin printed a cartoon of Bibi Netanyahu next to the Ten Commandments, scratching one of them out and suggesting that possibly he was going to violate another. I joined in that moment on Monday morning many students and community members, students who are here in the audience today, with a deep sense of feeling that that was crossed the line, that it was anti-Semitic. We reached out to the administration, who was quick to respond, and the Daily Bruin was quick to respond as well, both with condemnation and an apology. However, I can't help feeling that in that moment and the moments that followed it, possibly something was lost. There was a conversation to be had that when we moved into advocacy mode, changed, because we changed from let's have a conversation with our fellow students, let's educate our fellow students about what this is, and we changed into let's tell them what's wrong with their thinking. And there are moments for that, but what I appreciated about your column was that you were willing to stop for a moment and say, no, there's actually really important questions that I want to ask and understand. And then as soon as it went into social media, of course, it devolved further. So in framing a short question for you, which perhaps, and I heard the topic of today's lecture, you'll be able to answer, it is how can we simultaneously advocate an advocacy, which is important when you've decided that something is offensive, when you've decided that something needs to happen in the world, how do you engage both in advocacy without losing access to the deep thinking and different perspectives that we all so desperately need today? So without further ado, I would like to invite Professor Judea Pearl, who really in this space needs no introduction, but has become a deep friend to our students at UCLA. Hillel, and a personal.
Thank you, Aaron and Carl. And thank you all for being with us. And I see here friends, I see supporters, I see colleagues, I see sponsors. And thank you all for attending the 15th Daniel Pearl Memorial Lectures, a event which has become a cultural milestone in the community, an event for sharing values and sharing aspirations. I want to start by highlighting the generosity of our speaker, BRET STEPHENS, for taking time out of his busy schedule, leaving the center of national and international action, and taking a flight to the Wild West, you know, to say, to pay homage to a fellow journalist that was taken from us 15 years ago. Yes, it was February 21st, 2002, that Ruth and I received that fatal phone call from Mr. Bauman, the U.S. ambassador to Pakistan. As I was scanning the list of speakers, like you spoke, Cal, I noticed that the lecture tonight rectifies a glaring injustice. Among our 15 speakers, three from CNN, two from the New York Times, one from ABC, one from NPR, and none from the Wall Street Journal. To make up for this oversight, I will tell you a story about Danny. In 1994, he got an offer from the New York Times. And he went through several excruciating weeks of deciding, and he couldn't make up his mind. At the end, he decided to stay with the journal. Why, we ask him? Because it is a better paper, he said. And because I can improve the front page. I think he was right on both counts. Just last month, a person my age approached me and confessed that he's still missing getting up in the morning, sipping his coffee, and searching for Daniel Pearl quirky stories which appeared in the middle column of the journal, A-head, they used to call them. They still have them? Good. It was through these A-heads that we learn how sturgeons on the Caspian Sea turn into caviar, and why Yemen and Ethiopia cannot agree on who owns the real Queen of Sheba, and how Al-Qaeda financed its operation by mining Tanzanite gems on the slope of Mount Kilimanjaro. After the tragedy, it was a contribution and encouragement of the Wall Street Journal that enabled us to start the foundation. So thank you, BRET, for honoring our son with your lecture tonight, and for everything you and your colleagues and the journalistic community have done to keep his legacy alive.
BRET STEPHENS is the deputy editor of the editorial page of the Wall Street Journal. He writes Global View, the journal's foreign affairs column, for which he won the Pulitzer Prize for commentary in 2013. BRET joined the journal in 1998 as an op-ed editor, moved to Brussels the following year, wrote editorials, and edited a column on the EU. He left the paper in January 2002 to become editor-in-chief of the Jerusalem Post. He returned to the journal in 2004 and has reported stories from around the globe since. His other awards include a South Asian Journalists Association Prize for his coverage of the Kashmir earthquake in 2006, the Brindle Prize for excellence in opinion journalism in 2008, the Bastiat Prize for his columns on economics in 2010, and the University of Chicago's Professional Achievement Award in 2014. He is the author of America in Retreat, The New Isolationism and the Coming Global Disorder, published, I'll note, in 2014. which certainly seems prophetic today as we sit here in 2017. Brett graduated with honors from the University of Chicago and has an MA from the London School of Economics. Please join me in welcoming to UCLA this year's Daniel Pearl Lecture.
Thank you. Thank you for coming coming out this evening. I'm profoundly honored to have this opportunity to celebrate the legacy of Daniel Pearl, my colleague at the Wall Street Journal. The topic for this evening is intellectual integrity in the age of Donald Trump. I suspect this is a theme that would have resonated with Danny. When you work at the Wall Street Journal, the coins of the realm are truth and trust, the latter flowing exclusively from the former. When you read a news story in the journal, you do so with the assurance that immense repertorial and editorial effort has been expended to make sure that what you read is factual. Not probably factual, not partially factual, not alternatively factual. I mean fundamentally, comprehensively, and exclusively factual, and therefore trustworthy. This is how we operate. This is how Danny operated. This is how he died, losing his life in an effort to nail down a story. In the 15 years since Danny's death, the list of murdered journalists has grown very long. Paul Klebnikov and Anna Politkovskaya in Russia, Sattar Behesti and Zahra Kazemi in Iran, Jim Foley and Steve Sotloff in Syria, 5 journalists in Turkey, 26 journalists in Mexico, 110 journalists in Iraq. When we honor Danny, we honor them too. And we do more than that. We honor the central idea of journalism, the conviction, as my old boss Peter Kahn once said, that facts are facts, that they are ascertainable through honest, open-minded, and diligent reporting, that truth is attainable by laying fact upon fact, much like the construction of a cathedral, and that truth is not merely in the eye of the beholder. And we also honor this, the opportunity to separate truth from falsehood, which is never more important than when powerful people insist that falsehoods are truths or that there is no such thing as truth to begin with. So that's the business we're in, the business of journalism. Or as the 45th president of the United States likes to call us, the, and I quote, disgusting and corrupt media. Now, some of you may have noticed that we're living through a period in which the executive branch of government is engaged in a systematic effort to create a climate of opinion against the news business. The president routinely describes reporting he dislikes as, in all caps, fake news. The administration openly calls the press, quote, the opposition party, ridicules news organizations it doesn't like as business failures, and calls for individual journalists, including yours truly, to be fired. Mr. Trump has called for rewriting libel laws in order to more easily sue reporters and their news organizations. This is not unprecedented in American history, though you probably would have to go back to the administration of John Adams to see something quite like it. And so far, the rhetorical salvos haven't been matched by legal or regulatory action, and maybe they never will be. But the question of what Mr. Trump might yet do by political methods against the media matters a great deal less than what he is now attempting to do by ideological and philosophical methods. Ideologically, the president is trying to depose the so-called mainstream media in favor of media he likes, for example, Sean Hannity, Breitbart. Another way of making this point is to say that he's trying to substitute news for propaganda, information for boosterism. His objection to, for example, the New York Times isn't that there is a liberal bias in the paper that gets in the way of its objectivity, which I would think might be a fair criticism. His objection is to objectivity itself. He's perfectly happy for the media to be disgusting and corrupt so long as it's on his side. But again, that's not all that the president is attempting to do. Consider this recent exchange that he had with Bill O'Reilly. O'Reilly asks, and I quote, "Is there any validity to the criticism of you that you say things that you can't back up factually, and as the president, you say there are 3 million illegal aliens who voted and you don't have the data to back that up? Some people are going to say that it's irresponsible for the president to say that." It's O'Reilly. To which the president replies, "Many people have come out and said I'm right." Many people also say that Jim Morrison faked his own death. Many people insist that Barack Obama was born in Kenya. Many people say is what's known as an argumentum ad populum, and if we were a nation of logicians, we would dismiss that argument as dumb. We are not a nation of logicians. I think it's important not to dismiss the president's reply merely as dumb. We ought to assume that it's darkly brilliant, if not in intention, then certainly in effect. The president is responding to a claim of fact, not by denying the fact, but by denying the claim. Now, what he's doing is he isn't telling O'Reilly that he's got his facts wrong. He's saying that, as far as he is concerned, facts, as most of us in this room understand the term, don't matter, that they are indistinguishable from and interchangeable with opinion, and that a statement of fact needn't have any purchase against a man who is either who is either sufficiently powerful to ignore them or sufficiently shameless to deny them, or in his case, both. If some of you in this room are students of political philosophy, you know where this argument originates. This is an adaptation of Thrasymachus' argument in Plato's Republic that justice is the advantage of the stronger, and that injustice, and I quote, "if it is on a large enough scale, is stronger, freer, and more masterly than justice." Substitute the words truth and falsehood for justice and injustice, and there you have the Trumpian view of the world. If I had to sum it up in a single sentence, it would be this: truth is what you can get away with. If you can sell condos by claiming your building is 90% occupied when it's only 20% occupied, well then, it's 90% occupied. If you can convince a sufficient number of people that you really did win the popular vote or that your inauguration crowds were the biggest ever, well then, what do the statistical data and aerial photographs matter? Now, we could have some interesting conversations about why this is happening and why it seems to be happening all of a sudden. Today, we have disintermediating technologies like Twitter, which have cut out the media as the middleman. Today, just 17% of adults aged 18 to 24 read a newspaper daily, down from 42% at the turn of the century, just 17 years ago. Today, there are fewer than 33,000 full-time newsroom employees, a drop from 55,000 just 20 years ago. When Trump attacks us in the media, in the news media, he is kicking a wounded animal. But the most interesting conversation is not about why Trump lies. Many public figures, celebrities as well as politicians, lie, and he's only a severe example of a very common type. The interesting question concerns how we come to accept those lies. Now, nearly 25 years ago, Daniel Patrick Moynihan, the great scholar and Democratic senator from New York, coined the phrase defining deviancy down. His topic at the time was crime and how American society has come to accept ever-increasing rates of violent crime as normal. This is what he said: "We have been redefining deviancy so as to exempt much conduct previously stigmatized, and also quietly raising the, quote, normal level in categories where behavior is now abnormal by any earlier standard. Now, you can point to all sorts of ways in which this redefinition of deviancy has also been the story of our politics over the past 30 years, a story with a fully bipartisan set of villains. I personally think we crossed a Rubicon in the Clinton years when three things happened. We decided that some types of presidential lies didn't matter. We concluded that character was an overrated consideration when it came to judging a president. And we allowed the lines between political culture and celebrity culture to become completely blurred. But whatever else one might say about President Clinton, what we now have is the crack cocaine version of a similar situation. If a public figure tells a whopping lie once in his life, it will haunt him to his grave. If a public figure lies morning, noon, and night, it will become almost impossible to remember any one particular lie. Outrage will fall victim to its own ubiquity. It's the same truth contained in Stalin's famous remark that the death of one man is a tragedy, but the death of a million is a statistic. One of the most interesting phenomena during the presidential campaign was waiting for Trump to say that one thing that would surely break the back of his candidacy. Would it be his slander against Mexican immigrants as rapists and criminals? Or his slur about John McCain's record as a POW? Or his lie about New Jersey Muslims celebrating 9/11? Or his serial attacks on Megyn Kelly, a disabled reporter from the New York Times, or a Mexican-American judge? Would it be him tweeting quotations from Benito Mussolini, or his sly overtures to David Duke and the alt-right? Would it be his unwavering praise of Vladimir Putin? Would it be his refusal to release his tax returns, or the fraud that seems to be perpetrated on the saps who signed up for his Trump U courses? Would it be the transcript or the audio transcript of his conversation on that bus with Billy Bush? None of this, it turned out, made the slightest difference. On the contrary, it may have helped him. Some people become desensitized by the never-ending assaults on what was once quaintly known as human decency. Others seemed to positively admire the comments as refreshing examples of personal authenticity and political incorrectness. Shameless rhetoric will always find a receptive audience with shameless people. Donald Trump's was the greatest political striptease act in US political history. The dirtier he got, the more skin he showed, the more his core supporters seemed to like it. Abraham Lincoln, in his first inaugural address, called on Americans to summon the better angels of our nature. Donald Trump's candidacy, and so far his presidency, has been Lincoln's exhortation in reverse. Here's a simple truth about a politics of dishonesty, insult, and scandal. It's entertaining. Politics, as we've had it most of my life, has, with very few exceptions, been distant and dull. Now it's all that we can talk about. If you like Trump, his presence in the White House is a daily extravaganza of sticking it to pompous elites and querulous reporters. If you hate Trump, you wake up every day with some fresh outrage to turn over in your head and text your friends about. Whichever way, one of those friends is in the front row. Whichever way, it's exhilarating. Haven't all of us noticed that everything feels speeded up, more vivid, more intense, and consequential? One of the benefits of an alternative facts administration is that fiction can pretty much take you anywhere. Earlier today, at his press conference, the president claimed his administration is running like, and I quote, a fine-tuned machine. In actual fact, he just lost his labor secretary nominee, his national security advisor was forced out in disgraceful circumstances, and the intelligence community is refusing to fully brief the president for fear he might compromise sources and methods. But who cares? Since when in Washington has there been a presidential press conference like that? Since when has the denial of reality been taken to such an extreme? At some point, it becomes increasingly easy for people to mistake the reality of the performance for reality itself. If Trump can get through a press conference like that without showing a hint of embarrassment, remorse, or misgiving, well then, that becomes a new basis on which the president can now be judged. To tell a lie is wrong, but to tell a lie with aplomb, that takes some kind of skill. Ultimately, Trump's press conferences will be judged not on some kind of Olympic point system, but on whether he, quote, won, which is to say, whether he brazened his way through it. And the answer to that is almost certainly yes. So far I've offered you three ideas about how it is that we've come to accept the president's behavior. The first is that we normalize it simply by becoming inured to constant repetition of the same behavior. The second is that at some level it excites and entertains us. By putting aside our usual moral filters, the ones that tell us that truth matters, that upright conduct matters, that things ought to be done in a certain way, we have been given tickets to this spectacle in which all you want to do is watch and watch. And the third thing is that we adopt new metrics of judgment in which politics become more about perceptions than performance, of how a given action is perceived as being perceived. If a reporter for the New York Times says that Trump's press conference probably plays well in Peoria, as Maggie Haberman did earlier today, then it increases the chances that it will play well in Peoria. Now let me add one fourth point here, and that's our tendency to rationalize. One of the more fascinating aspects of last year's presidential campaign was the rise of a class of pundits I call the Trump explainers. For instance, Trump would give a speech or offer an answer in a debate that amounted to a little more than a word jumble. But rather than quote Trump or point out that what he had said was grammatically and logically nonsensical, the Trump explainers would tell us that what he had allegedly meant to say. They became our political semioticians, ascribing pattern and meaning to the runestones of Trump's mind. If Trump said he'd get Mexico to pay for the wall, you could count on someone to provide a complex tariff scheme to make good on that threat. If Trump said that we should not have gone into Iraq, but once there, we should have, quote, taken the oil, we'd have a similarly high-flown explanation as to how we could engineer this massive act of theft. A year ago, when he was trying to explain his idea of a foreign policy to the New York Times' David Sanger, the reporter asked him whether his views didn't amount to a kind of America First policy, a reference to the isolationist and often anti-Semitic America First Committee that tried to prevent US entry into World War II. Trump clearly had never heard of the group, but he liked the phrase and he made it his own. And that's how we got the return of America First. More recently, I came across this headline in the conservative Washington Times newspaper. This is the headline: How Trump's quote-unquote disarray may be merely a strategy, which was a column by Wes Pruden, the paper's former editor-in-chief. In his view, the president's first supposedly, seemingly disastrous month in office is in fact evidence of a refreshing openness on the president's part to dissent, which, the writer added, is reminiscent of the cabinets of George Washington and Abraham Lincoln. Sure. Overall, the process is one in which explanation becomes rationalization, which in turn becomes justification. Trump says X. What he really means is Y. And while you might not like that, he's giving voice to the angers and anxieties of Z, who, by the way, you're not allowed to question or criticize because anxiety and anger are their own justifications these days. Watching this process unfold has been particularly painful for me as a conservative columnist. I find myself in the awkward position of having recently become popular among some of my liberal peers precisely because I have not changed my opinions about anything. By contrast, I've become suddenly unpopular among some of my former fans on the right, again, because I've simply stuck to my views. It is almost amusing to be accused of suffering from something called Trump derangement syndrome. This is a term of abuse on the right, if you're not aware of it. Simply because I feel an obligation to raise my voice against, for example, the president suggesting moral equivalency between the United States and Vladimir Putin's Russia, as he did the other night on O'Reilly. The most painful aspect of this has been to watch people I once considered thoughtful and principled conservatives give themselves over to a species of illiberal politics from which I once thought they were immune. In his 1953 masterpiece, The Captive Mind, the Polish poet and dissident Czesław Miłosz analyzed the psychological and intellectual pathways through which some of his former colleagues in Poland's post-war communist regime allowed themselves to be converted into ardent Stalinists. In none of the cases that Miłosz analyzed was coercion the main reason for their conversion. They wanted to believe. They were willing to adapt. They thought they could do more good from the inside. They convinced themselves that their former principles didn't fit with the march of history, or that to hold fast to one's belief was a sign of priggishness and pig-headedness. They felt that to reject the new order of things was to relegate themselves to irrelevance and political oblivion. They mocked their former friends who refused to join the new order as morally vain reactionaries. They convinced themselves that, brutal and capricious as Stalinism might be, it couldn't possibly be worse than the exploitative capitalism of the West. I fear we are witnessing a similar process unfold among many conservative intellectuals on the right. It has been stunning to watch a movement that once believed in the benefits of free trade and free enterprise merrily give itself over to a champion protectionist whose economic instincts recall the corporatism of 1930s Italy or of 1950s Argentina. It is no less stunning to watch people who once mocked Obama for being too soft on Russia suddenly discover the virtues of Trump's pragmatism on exactly the same subject. And it is nothing short of amazing to watch the party of one-time moral majoritarians who spent a decade fulminating about Bill Clinton's sexual habits suddenly find complete comfort with the idea that character and temperament are irrelevant qualifications for the highest office in the country. The mental pathways by which the new Trumpian conservatives have made their peace with their new political master aren't so different from Miloš's former colleagues. There's the same desperate desire for political influence, the same belief that Trump represents a historical force to which they ought to belong, the same willingness to bend or discard principles they once considered sacred, the same fear of seeming out of touch with the mood of the public, the same willingness to look the other way at comments or actions that they cannot possibly justify, the same belief that you do more harm, that you do more good than harm by joining than by opposing, and the same Manichaean belief that if Hillary Clinton had been elected, the United States would have ended as a country within 4 years. This is supposed to be the road of pragmatism, of making lemonade from lemons. I would counter that it's the road of ignominy, of hitching a ride with a drunk driver. So then, this is the subject that brings me here today, maintaining intellectual integrity in the age of Trump. When Judea wrote me last summer to ask if I'd be this year's speaker, I got my copy of Danny's collected writings, At Home in the World. and I began to read him all over again. It brought back to me the fact that the reason we honor Danny's memory today isn't that he is a martyred journalist. It's that he was a great journalist. Let me show you what I mean. Here's something Danny wrote in February 2001, almost exactly a year before his death, from the site of an earthquake disaster in the town of Anjar in India. What is India's earthquake zone really like? It smells. It reeks. You can't imagine the odor of several hundred bodies decaying for 5 days as search teams pick away at slabs of crumbled buildings in this town. Even if you've never smelled it before, the brain knows what it is and orders you to get away. After a day, the nose gets stuffed up in self-defense, but the brain has registered the scent and picks it up in innocent places. Lip balm, sweet candy, stale breath, an airplane seat. What stands out for me in this passage is that it shows that Danny was a writer who observed with all of his senses. He saw, he listened, he smelled, he bore down, he reflected. He understood that what the reader had to know about Anjar wasn't a collection of statistics of how many people died, how and where. It was the visceral reality of a massive human tragedy. And he was able to express all this in language that was compact, unadorned, compelling, and deeply true. George Orwell wrote, "To see what is in front of one's nose needs a constant struggle." Danny saw what was in front of his nose. We each have our obligations to see what's in front of our noses, whether we're reporters, columnists, or anything else. This is the essence of intellectual integrity. Not to look around or beyond or away from the facts, but to look straight at them, to recognize and call them for what they are, nothing more or less. To believe in an epistemology that can distinguish between truth and falsity, facts and wishes, evidence and opinions. To see things for what they are before we interpret them for what we would wish them to be. To defend the habits of mind and the institutions, above all, a free press, fundamentally invested in preserving those habits of mind. To hold ourselves fast to a set of intellectual standards and moral convictions that won't waver or change, or won't waver in changes of fashion or tides of unfavorable opinion. To speak the truth, irrespective of what it might mean for the time being, for our personal popularity or our political influence. The legacy of Daniel Pearl is that he died for this. We are being asked to do much less. We have no excuse not to do it. Thank you very much.
Brett, I'm going to confess I'm a New York Times reader, but you've maybe swayed me to the other side. That was great.
My wife is a music critic for the New York Times. It's got a terrific art section. They do other things okay. They're not bad. They're working their way up.
So let me start. I want to ask you how far you will take that argument, which I found very compelling. So you focused on the president. I wholeheartedly agree with what you said. Let me ask you about, and we will turn to foreign affairs in a moment, but let me ask you about Mitch McConnell, Paul Ryan, others in the Republican Party, other conservatives. You talked about getting in the car with a drunk driver.
Yep.
And is that what you see them doing? And if so, how do you understand or explain that?
Those words were carefully chosen. And I think that the GOP had an opportunity at various points in the campaign to realize that sometimes it's worth losing an election to maintain your honor. And what I fear has happened and will happen with every passing week of this administration is that honor will be compromised. people have long political memories. Jews certainly have long political memories. People will not forget for a long time, and especially I mean people who are younger in this audience, that when it given the choice, the Republican Party opted to make its standard bearer a man with this set of values and views. And, you know, in normal politics, the wheel turns. And I remember watching Bill Clinton say, the year of big government's over in the mid-1990s. 15 years later, Obama was signing the Affordable Care Act. 1964, Barry Goldwater got destroyed. 16 years later, Ronald Reagan was elected. So political wheels turn, but political reputations don't turn quite so easily. And I think that the Republicans in Congress, I mean, I don't envy them. They're politicians, after all. I wouldn't envy any politician. Have done their party's brand, its reputation, its historical reputation, no favors. I mean, just think of the arc of, I'm sorry to go on. We went from 47 years ago to Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall, to, and I quote, because he's now the president, I moved on her like a bitch. That's the arc of our party. Not good.
One comparison that's sometimes drawn, and I don't want to equate these two, but just on this issue of arcs of parties or the longevity of a party. Here in California, if you went back to the early 90s, Pete Wilson ran on a very strongly anti-immigrant stance for governor, won. Prop 187 was passed, and the Republican Party has never recovered.
Yep.
Do you see the same happening on a national level?
I fear it's going to happen. And listen, even to those of you who are liberals in this room, I think you want a politics in which there is a healthy, morally decent right of center party. I think you want a Republican Party that stands for opportunity, inclusion, aspiration, even if you have all kinds of fundamental differences on various policy and even moral questions. You want a Republican Party so that when the Republican is in charge, you don't feel a constant need to shower. And that makes for a healthy society. And by the way, one of my deep fears about a Trump presidency is that he's going to turn the Democrats crazy. And I think, in fact, that's his intention, which is to bring out the angry aspects on the left as well, and turn the Republic, just as he turned the Republican Party into a party of its fringes, do sort of effect a similar transformation by way of reaction to the Democratic Party. And that's an unhealthy politics. America has been extraordinarily well served by having two major parties that are centrist parties, right? Two major parties where you don't wake up in the morning and say, so-and-so won, I'm buying a ticket, you know, to Ottawa, New Zealand, wherever people buy tickets to these days, and have to leave. I grew up in Mexico City, so I know what dysfunctional politics can look like, although in that case it was just a one-party system. But we're heading in a bad direction if this continues. And I'll just say one more thing. I think it's my task as a conservative columnist to do my tiny little bit in upholding the honor of the conservative political tradition in its best form. That's effectively the way I see my role.
It's admirable and you do it well. Let me turn to a couple of the foreign policy issues you raised. Maybe we could start with Russia. So in my life, the Republican Party has always been known as a staunchly anti-communist and even anti-Russian party. And up until 2 years ago, I would have thought that was still true. And as you pointed out, somehow this change has occurred. So we could explain the causes of it, but I'm interested in your view on the consequences. So one, what do you see happening in the next year or two with regard to the U.S.-Russia relationship? And do you think in terms of the, I don't know how to characterize what's happening in terms of Trump and his entourage in Russia. But do you think we're at the beginning of that story, the end of that story? Where do you see us in a year?
You know, as Niels Bohr said, the future is, or prediction is very difficult, especially about the future.
I always thought it was Yogi Berra.
No, it's a profound observation. People don't think about it enough. But Niels Bohr was a physicist at a level to think it through. Look, I mean, there are two questions. One is a simple political guess, which is that ultimately Putin and Trump will not be able to get along. These are two alpha male types. George W. Bush looked into Putin's soul, and 8 years later, the relationship was in a dreadful situation. Obama wanted his reset with Putin, same deal. I don't think it's going to turn out better for Trump, and it might happen in a fairly rapid way. Assuming, and this is a giant assumption, that there isn't some piece of compromise that the Russian government has over the 45th president of the United States, which is just a kind of a one of those head-exploding thoughts that happens to be true.
Can you explain his relationship with Putin, though, any other way than that?
Yeah.
I don't want to derail your answer, but that's such an important element for so many people. What is it that motivates him? And that's one obvious
Well, the thing option. Is, we don't know. I mean, I don't want to allege things I don't know. There is enough information out there that is in the public sphere to raise questions about the nature of the relationship, and that those suspicions have not been helped by the president's adamant refusals, and by the way, lies, and I use this word lies deliberately, to disclose his tax returns and give us a full picture of his finances. But there are other explanations that are, in some sense, less compromising, but not less excusable. One of them is what seems to be a fascination with the president for autocratic figures and autocratic methods of government, where, you know, he will praise Putin repeatedly as a strong leader. Putin, he will say, is a strong leader of his country. Now, Putin is a feared leader of his country because Putin rules by fear. And ask Alexei Navalny or Garry Kasparov or any number of journalists, one of whom was recently poisoned, Vladimir Karamurza, who's just recovering from being in a coma, about what Putin's regime is like. So you have a president democratically elected who seems to worship the concept of the strong leader as it was sort of defined in the 1920s and 1930s as the charismatic man of action who doesn't care about parliamentary niceties, doesn't care about democratic rights, doesn't care about respecting the ongoing institutions of a free civil society. And in that sense, Putin seems to be a kind of a pretty good role model for this president. That he does all this, why can't we?
Let me turn to the intelligence community. So yesterday—
Other than that, I'm a great supporter of the president.
Is there anything you like about him?
You know, the standard line, you know, he's raised wonderful children. I don't think that either. And it's not only that I'm not sure they're so wonderful, he didn't raise them.
Do you have tenure at the Wall Street Journal? How does that work?
I may not after today. I think I'm all right. I want this presidency to succeed. Let me put it this way. I genuinely want the presidency to succeed because now, like it or not, we're in this common boat. I don't want us hurtling towards a constitutional crisis between an intelligence community that thinks it can't trust the president with vital national secrets and a president who, on the one hand, is trying to exercise legitimate executive authority over departments of his government, but on the other hand, maybe wanting to exercise it for illegitimate means. But I think we all should want, you know, nothing would make me happier if someone staged, if Ivanka or whoever staged some giant intervention, said, Dad, calm down. Your presidency is headed towards certain calamity. You don't want to be remembered the way we remember Nero, Caligula, other figures in history. let's just have a normal Republican administration shut up and let Mattis do whatever and bring in someone reasonable on other fronts. So I want him to succeed. I don't, you know, and by the way, when Obama was president, I wanted him to succeed too. I think that should be, that's a patriotic standard. But, you know, being raised by a mother who believed that criticism was the highest form of love, I also feel I have to exercise my critical responsibilities too.
So yesterday, the president met with Benjamin Netanyahu. Mm-hmm. And in a kind of, we talked about this a little bit in advance, but I know the audience will be interested in your take on this. So some have characterized this as overthrowing years of American policy towards Israel and towards the conflict. I don't think you necessarily share that view, but how do you see what's happening in that relationship? And what's the significance of the fact that he almost offhandedly announced his equivocation between one state, two state, whatever they want?
Well, look, you know, I mean, there is an argument to be made, and it's a serious argument, that the two-state solution has kind of played itself out. I don't buy that argument. I think that at least in theory, the two-state solution ought to be the goal of policy. The problem is, I would also argue, it's not currently realizable in practice. So how do you go about creating a set of circumstances by which you can manage your way until you get to the place you need to be, where, in my view, the Palestinians can demonstrate that they can exercise responsible, mature self-government in a way that doesn't threaten core national interests of Israel. So that's an argument. But I guess I wasn't so much bothered by two-state, one-state. It was that sinking feeling I had that he had no idea of what he was talking about. And this is the wonk in me that actually believes that you should have some at least pretense of knowing what's going on. I mean, this has only been the daily newspaper fare of Donald Trump. Donald Trump was born in 1946. Israel comes into being when he's two, all right? This has been on newspapers forever, all right? And anyone, you would think, you would feel this embarrassment about not having what seems to be a kind of passing acquaintance with what these subjects are about beyond kind of the flickering reflection of an impression you had on the TV. And that also bothers me. I think the presidency is a job that comes with certain requirements, intellectual requirements. And by the way, if there are people in this audience maybe who will say, Stevens is such a snob, believe me, I've been in green rooms with people who've told me this. I once made the case on Fareed Zakaria, as I said, the American people deserve a president who can speak grammatical English, right? I was debating someone who was a columnist for the Washington Times, a supporter of Trump. She looked at me, she said, that is so snobbish. Now, here you have a president whose main objection is, it seems, that he has to, you know, oprime dos para español, you know, like God forbid people are speaking other languages. Maybe someone could make that case, but I just want him to speak my own language. And I don't think it's too much to ask. And I know that I'm coming across as a terrible cultural elitist. I'm not a cultural elitist, right? My mother has a high school degree from nearby here, by the way, and came to this country as a refugee. I just don't think it's a much of a requirement. And I think, by the way, it says something about us culturally when the idea that you should have some intellectual preparation for the job of the presidency is considered a kind of elite and therefore suspect idea.
Since you mentioned you brought up refugees and this question of his competence. So one of the theories that I've heard from a conservative, not a liberal, is that what most people would characterize as the chaotic, catastrophic rollout of his executive order was neither, and in fact was planned and or intended, wanted, welcomed. And that there's some desire that it was so badly done and so ill thought out and so poorly written and drafted that it could only have had some ulterior motive.
This must be Jack.
Goldsmith.
Yeah.
He's one of the people who has said this. But others have too. And so do you, respond to that and tell me what you
think. This entire speech, which I hope gets published somewhere, this entire speech is an effort to counter that view, which is to say, you have the evidence before you is that an executive order of questionable legality was rolled out in an unquestionably incompetent way, creating a huge political furor that consumed the political agenda of a president who has only so many weeks to start getting things done legislatively. And the smart people say, ah, there's a pattern here. And they're smart enough to see the pattern, right? Because they can't simply accept that incompetence, idiocy, and ill will are powerful forces in this world. This is essentially a problem that any intellectual person confronts at some point, which is that you can figure out something clever to say about unclever things. And there's a danger in mistaking your own cleverness and your ability to create these patterns out of nothing from failing to see the thing for what it is. Again, I come back to this Orwell quote, to see what's in front of one's nose requires needs a constant struggle. And that's what I'm trying to do. I mean, so I read that piece, and you must have talked to him about it, but this happens all the time. There's someone who's going to be smart enough to say, oh, there's something to this. And by the way, that intellectual conceit is also its own desire for power. It's its own way of saying, I see through this, and here's what you really want to do, Mr. President. And by the way, I'll bet you that if Trump picks up on this 6 months from now, he'll say, yeah, it was all intentional. Throwing you off the scent.
I'm going to ask one final question and open it up. So one of the interesting things about your biography, which you referenced earlier, is that you grew up in Mexico. And so here in California, we obviously have a deep, longstanding relationship with Mexico, but that was
not always a happy one.
No, not always a happy one. And that was obviously a signature feature of the campaign, but it's also one of the most important trading relationships we have, very important political relationship. So what would you like to see the U.S.-Mexico relationship look like?
I'd like Americans to realize that we are blessed to have Mexico as a neighbor. Mexico's a fantastic country. Its people are immensely talented. They have made incredible strides in the last 25 years in coming to a democracy where previously they had effectively a dictatorship, in trying to at least fight where they used to collude with the narco traffickers, to improve the standards of living for their people, to turn Mexico from a poor country to a middle-income country. And now they are being spat in the face by this president. And it is, as Talleyrand once said, it is worse than a crime, it is a blunder. Mexico has had a succession of middle-of-the-road presidents who have pursued modern, sophisticated economic agendas. There's no reason why Mexico can't elect its own version of Hugo Chavez. None, and they might, because there's an election coming up in about 16 months or so. And just imagine what would happen to the United States if we had today's Venezuela on our border, a massive refugee crisis, starving people south of the border, an anti-American dictator making friends with Syria, with Iran, with Russia, which is what the Chavistas have all done. People in positions of power, the vice president of the country being indicted as narco traffickers, relationships with terrorist groups like the FARC. That's all possible. Mexico chose another path. So how do we reward them? By electing a man who says that their people are A, criminals, B, rapists, and O, there might be some good people, right? Threatening to build a wall and then have them pay for it through some kind of scheme. You know, Trump came to visit us at the editorial board of the Wall Street Journal. We said to him, you know, if you cut off NAFTA, if you build this wall, you know, you might immiserate Mexico and create terrible political conditions there. You know what he said? I don't care. I do not care. That's Mexico's problem. And that is a zero-sum mentality that serves America very well. We are part of a world.
Do you mean well or poorly?
Excuse me?
You said it served us well. Do you mean
Excuse
poorly?
Me. I forgot what preceded it. what I'm saying is we have lived in a world in which we have tried to enrich our neighbors. We have brought Western Europe up from despair after World War II through the Marshall Plan. We have helped transform South Korea into a first world economy. We turned Japan and Germany, the two most dangerous countries of the first half of the 20th century, into two of the most pacific democratic countries.
Extraordinary accomplishment.
It's an extraordinary achievement. And we did all this through an internationalist foreign policy that rested on the belief that your gain could also be my gain, that it was not a zero-sum equation. And now we have a president who doesn't seem to get that. And I think that's a really dismaying thought. And I think one of the things, I look at all these flags on the wall, and they're all here, and they represent not just their own individual countries, they represent a country, this country, that wants to put all those flags on the wall, that wants students from each one of those countries here on the campus, and that understands that this campus is that much better because those flags are on these walls and those students are in this country. That's the kind of government I'd like.